This is part 2 of 2 on the meaning of confidence intervals, and this part includes several graphical simulations. Here's the first run in my simulation. It'll show the number of runs that I've done at the bottom, and it'll report the number of times the confidence intervals were outside of the true population mean. So each run might be each student performing the experiment, collecting 3 measurements at a time. So this is student number 1. Student number 1 indeed encompassed mu. Here's student number 2. Also included mu. Student number 3, 4, 5. Look what happened to student 5. This particular range we sampled happened to sample on the upper end of the normal distribution. And in doing so, we got an estimate that did not include the true population mean. However, we don't ever get to know when this happens. We just have to take the math at face value that only on average 5 times out of 100 we're going to miss the population mean. So let's keep going with it. There's another instance. Look at the wide range of confidence intervals. Some of them are real wide, some real narrow. So another one missed back there. We're up to 3 of them outside of the confidence interval, a 4th one. And here, out of 100 runs, 100 different students, only 4 missed the confidence interval. Only 4 confidence intervals were outside of the true population mean. Now, it's not strictly true that there will always be 5 missing out of 100, but on average, if we ran 1,000, then we might collect something like 50 samples, or 49, or 52, or 53. On average, it'll be much closer to what we would expect, this 5% missing. Let's run some experiments now in which students collect 7 different measurements. They break 7 different parts. And in this case, we'll see alpha is still 0.05. And out of 20 parts, we would have expected one of them to miss, but none of them have yet. Student 40 missed one of them. We would expect by now that we'd miss 2. So we just haven't run enough experiments to find this 5%. It varies over time, but let's run it all the way up. We'll run 100 runs, so all 100 students taking a sample of 7 measurements each. Incidentally, compare the length of these confidence intervals to what we had done before when n was only equal to 3. The bigger the sample size, the tighter your error bars will be, but still, on average, 5% of those will miss the true population mean. And again, 4 out of 100 miss the true population mean. Well, let's say instead of collecting only 7 measurements, let's say, well, let's work really hard. We're going to get a really good handle on this situation, and we're going to collect 100 measurements. Here's an example. N is equal to 100, so you'd be there all day. And note how the parts are clustered, the values are clustered near the population mean, and it's less likely on the outside of it. And the error bars tighten up quite a bit, and the sample mean begins to be more consistently closer to the population mean. As we keep running it, we again would expect 1 out of 20 to fall outside of the mean. So we didn't hit it yet. Oh, we got 1. We'd expect 2. Oh, there's 2. Got a few more. This student number's 80. There are 100 students, and this time there were 6 confidence intervals outside of the true population mean. And again, it's all random. It's just, on average, we'd expect about 5 out of 100 to miss it. So let's go back to something more realistic. We'll collect 3 samples with the same value of alpha of 0.05. Look at how large these error bars tend to be. In general, they're fairly large with only 3 samples. Remember, the more samples you collect, the tighter the error bars and the less fluctuation you'll see with X bar, with the sample mean. So let's say now, well, all right, we've arbitrarily chosen alpha of 0.05, missing about, meaning that about 5 of them will miss the true population mean out of 100. Let's say we want to be more careful. We only want to miss 1 out of 100. So we'll set alpha equal to 0.01. So in essence, we're going to say, I want to be really sure that an interval always, almost always encompasses the true population mean. And when I run that, look what happens to the size of the error bars. They get gigantic. If we ran this 100 times, that one got a little bit closer, 100 times, we would only expect one of them to miss the true population mean. The error bars are so large at a 99% confidence interval that it's almost useless. We would tell somebody that, you know, the parts can be either really strong or really weak, but we know the true mean is somewhere within that bounds, but it doesn't do us any good. we wanted to, we could try alpha equal to 0.01. In that case, only 1 in 1,000 would miss it. And those error bars are even bigger and even more useless. So people have figured out that 95% provides a nice compromise between the width of the intervals and the number of times that you actually miss the true population mean. Let's say, well, I only care if we miss it half the time. I like really tight error bars. It makes them look like I've got a better handle on the situation if our error bars are real small. So let's run it, instead of alpha of 0.01 or 0.05, let's run it at 0.5. And when I do that with alpha of 0.5, it means it's, on average, it's going to miss the true population mean half of the time. And look at how tight those error bars are. We'll continue running through this. Again, we've run 5 runs. The 2 out of the 5 runs have missed it. These error bars are too small to encompass the population mean at any given amount of time. So if we speed this up a bit, as we approach 50 runs, there's 25 of them that had missed the true population mean. Half of them fell outside of the true population mean. And lastly, if we want to be silly about this, let's do n equals 1,000. Here's n equals 1,000 with alpha equal to 0.05. Look at how close the sample mean is to the true population mean. Look at how tight these error bars are. And look at how the distribution of measurements, the wide majority of them are concentrated in towards the center of the normal distribution. There's a few outliers. This confidence interval does include, for this first run, or this first student who gathered 1,000 measurements, did calculate a confidence interval that included the true population mean. Here's another one. Another one. Look at how tight the sample mean is. It doesn't fluctuate very much. It's always fairly close, but it still will miss. And as I keep going, we would expect if I run this all the way up to the 100th student doing the same experiment, 5 out of those 100 students are likely to miss the true population mean in their confidence interval. And here we have 4 out of the 100 actually missed. But you'll notice that the sample mean really didn't fluctuate all that much. So when you're doing experiments and you're working with confidence intervals, just remember that the confidence interval does not represent the fraction of measurements that are outside of the confidence interval. It's a popular misconception. That's not true. If you want to say it, you say, well, if I ran this experiment, if I collected 3 or 5 or 7 samples in each experiment, the confidence interval that I'm calculating will not bracket the true population mean 5 times out of 100 if I've set alpha equal to 0.05. And you've got a couple of parameters to experiment with. The first one is the number of measurements you're going to take. That could be really time-consuming or really expensive if you're breaking things. And the other thing you have to think about is what value of alpha do you want to report? Do you want to report a small value of alpha that gives you a great deal of confidence that you've encompassed the true population mean? If you did so, your error bars would be really huge. If you wanted to do an alpha of 50%, for example, you'll have real tight error bars, but they're going to miss the population mean 50% of the time. So in general, engineers and statisticians have said 5%, alpha of equal to 0.05, is a nice happy median for representing error bars. And this is what you're doing when you report a 95% confidence interval.